Okay? So I'm going to talk about storytelling when it comes to data science. What happens is that nowadays there's a lot of data. There's a lot of data out there, and data science is a buzzword now. Every company wants to hire a data scientist. Every company wants to have some business intelligence tool. But it does not always translate into something that the company actually benefits from in the end. What does the data actually say to me? We have a bunch of graphs, we have Tableau, we have all that, and then what does it actually, how does it actually help us so that we can actually make it into something actionable and make a change that's going to benefit us? So we need to actually find a way to visualize our data properly and then communicate it to the stakeholders so that they can actually take in that data, understand the story behind it, and then do something with it. So our story has to have certain components. You have to talk about the situation. What is the situation, the context in which we are working? And then, what problem are we trying to solve here? Storytelling always has to follow a research-based approach. You cannot just, oh, tell a story like you're telling a story to, like I'm telling to my daughter. When it comes to storytelling with data, I need to follow a certain approach. I need to start with a problem and try to answer certain questions. Then, as I look for that story and I find a story, I need to find insights inside of my data, insights that I can share with the owners of the data. And then I need to actually point the compass to the future. What is next? I found a story, but what do I advise? What do I advise the stakeholder to do? So now, in the case of the examples we're going to look at, the background of the story is that we got the data from Harambe. Harambe is a non-governmental organization, and what they do is to try to find paths of employment for youths in South Africa as well as in Rwanda. So they partner with government, they partner with businesses, and they partner with young people who are seeking work. So they get them through a number of programs, and they help them find jobs in the end. And often they actually survey what is happening to people in their program, and that's where we get our data from, the feedback that we get from the employment journey of the people inside the program. So every time we have to find what is my problem. My problem is, in this case, that there is a problem of employment in South Africa. Young people are not working, and Harambe is trying to fix that problem at the best that it can. Now Harambe gave me their data, I need to start finding the story inside of it. The first thing that I would want to do is to explore my data set. What is actually inside of the data that they gave me? Because I didn't collect the data, I need to try and understand. Pandas give us a lot of tools. If you have done a bit of data science before, you have used Pandas. So Pandas gives us a lot of functions and a lot of attributes that after you've loaded data into a data frame, you can actually use to see what the data frame is all about. So here is the first example. I load my data set into a data frame called DF, and then when I say .head, I just have an overview of my data. The first five rows inside my data, so I have an idea. Every row has an ID, and then a certain date that the survey was done, and then every survey has a number, and then I get some particulars for the person that actually took the survey. Okay, cool. Then I actually want to know how many of these columns that I saw there have missing values. Because we always have to find out what are we looking at in terms of missing values. Because you have to decide in the end, do you want to discard them? Do you want to fill them up with something else? The mean of the column or the mode of the column, for example. So I use two functions from Pandas. IsNull tells me whether or not something is a missing value, and then the sum is going to now sum up all the values that are missing inside the function. So you see that there are some columns that are missing a lot of data. And in the end, I might actually decide, I can calculate the percentage of missing values and maybe discard columns that I have too many missing values. Maybe I won't use them. Or I can decide that I want to fill them with a value like zero, for example. And then pandas give us this function, describe. Describe gives you the stats of the numeric values you have inside of your data frame. So in our case, the only numeric values there was a column called unnamed, unique ID, and then the survey number. In this case, the mean and standard deviation and minimum and stuff don't really mean much. But if you have a variable like age, for example, describe can actually help you have a glimpse into the stats of that column. And then we have the types. Since we saw earlier, we only have three integer columns there, I want to know what type of variable do I have in the other columns. I see that most of them are objects. And when they are objects, I can't really do much with them in my analysis. So I keep that in mind. Most of them are objects, and I might need to convert them into something else. So D types allows you to see the data type stored in each one of the columns. So here I come to my next step. I do some data wrangling because, as I told you, I can't use my object variables for much. So in data wrangling, I'm just trying to fix my data set into something that I actually can use, like doing stuff like converting the data types, dealing with the missing values, and creating new features that I can use. And here's an example of the type conversion, where I'm taking all my objects and just converting them into categories that I can then use in my analysis and my visualizations. And then an example of feature engineering is that I get the date of birth, but what can it really help me determine? Not much. I need to know the age of the different participants in the survey. So using pandas, I convert the date of birth into a date, and then I now make a difference. I just calculate the difference between now and the date of birth as a date, and it gives me the age of every participant inside of my data frame. Now, after I've done my data wrangling, I can now start to do a bit of visualization. One type of visualization that I can do is to look at feature distributions. For example, the age that I just created, I want to know where kind of are they sitting, people in this survey? What age range are they sitting at? And you can see here that most of my people are here, between like 25 and 30, and then it gives you an idea that, oh, there's a lot of outliers as well. So you can decide later during your analysis, where are the outliers, and what do I want to do with the outliers? So you have an idea of this column. And I can also use a histogram. A histogram is not a bar chart. A histogram helps us know the frequency of a variable in a certain interval. Like in this case, for example, with pandas, you just call the data frame, call the column, and then say hist, and then it displays the histogram for you. So it tells me that most of my people, just like the box plot said, are sitting here between like 25 and 30. And then it gives me, I have about 10,000 sitting here between less than 20 and 25. And then it just gives me the frequency that I have in each interval. Other than feature distributions, I might also want to visualize feature-feature relationships. For example, I don't want to just have the age, but I want to know what is the age, the distribution of different age based on whether the people are working or not. So in blue here, there are the people not working. I have their age distribution. And then in orange there, there's the distribution of people who are actually working. Where are they distributed? And I see that in both cases, I mainly have, in Harambe program, we still mainly have people in this bracket here. And I might also want to see it as a box plot over another variable. So I want to see, for example, what is the age of people that I'm getting in different provinces? Does it change much? It kind of looks like it's the same still, and I can see now that most of my outliers are inside of Gauteng, for example. And then I can use that information when I report. Another nice thing to get feature-feature relationship is to get the correlation between the different variables. Pandas, again, just one function call, and you get the correlation between all the variables in your data set. So here, I just call df.core, and then I store it inside core, and it gives me the correlation between each one of my variable and every other one. But this might be difficult to kind of make sense of. So I can use a heat map. The heat map, I get something very clear on the heat map, it means there's a very high correlation. Around the purple here, it's like almost no correlation, and then when it's getting darker, it's negative correlation between the two variables. So you would see here, for example, that every variable is highly correlated to itself. So that's why the diagonal here is a very light color. And here, it kind of helps me figure out what variables are correlated to what other variables, instead of just having those numbers there. And for me to plot this, I used a library called Seaborn. I assume that Seaborn is installed, I import Seaborn, and then from Seaborn, I just call heatmap. I send in my correlation data frame that was created earlier. I tell it what to use as the labels on my x-axis and what to use as the labels on my y-axis, and there, it makes the heatmap for me. And it gives me more visualization of what's happening. I can also use a bar plot. In this case, for example, I want to kind of see what is the correlation between financial situation now and all the other variables. So it shows me that financial situation now has the highest correlation to itself, of course, and then it has the other variable that is highly correlated to is financial situation of that person 5 years ago. And here I just get an idea of what variables are actually linked to the financial situation and how that person perceives their current financial situation. I can also use a scatter plot to find feature-feature relationships. In this case here, I'm plotting age against the amount of months that person has been working. So what does it tell me here? It kind of tells me that most of our participants below 25 years old have not been working for more than 2 years. A lot of them are below 25 months, but when we get between 25 and 35, we just have an array of different values. People have been working very little, and some people have been working for very long. In this bracket, we just have everybody. And as we go down again, after 35, we see again that most people that are in the program and are older than 35 years old have not, their latest job has not been for a very long period. So that's the kind of information that the scatter plot gives you. So now, a real life example. After we got the data from Harambe, how can we tell a story out of it? Background. We always have to start with background. Context. The South African context. In this context of ours, men are more likely to work than women. And as you can see from that graph, it's not just that they are more likely to work, but again, also they are more likely to earn more. So Harambe kind of helps more women. It takes more youth, female youth, to help them in the path of employment. However, the problem is, when we find in our data, even though we have more women than men, the ratio of women not working is still higher. So why would that be? That's the problem here. Some insights that we get, I'm not going to go into all the insights, just an example of an insight, is that most women in our group have more responsibilities than the men in our group. For example, the number of children that they've reported that they take care of. Everywhere, the women are taking care of more children than the men. Therefore, they don't have enough time to actually look for jobs. And that's maybe why they don't find jobs, because they are busy doing other things. They're taking care of the kids, they're taking care of the house, they're doing all these other things, and it does not allow them maybe to actually have time to get a job. So what can I suggest to Harambe? I can suggest to Harambe to provide childcare in their facility for a limited time, that people can come in and leave their child for a limited time and go actually look for work. I can suggest to them to promote an inclusive workplace culture with their partners. They must make sure that they actually allow working women to have the flexibility to also juggle their responsibilities and work. And I can also advise them to teach their other youth, the men one, to actually understand that responsibilities are shared so that women can also have time to actually fulfill themselves. So in conclusion, what is storytelling? It's putting together data science, visualization, as well as narrative, so that you can convey a message from the data to the stakeholder. And the best practice, create an interesting presentation. When you go there, make sure that you're using the proper labels, you're using the proper colors, and something that's really attractive, that they actually is gonna attract their eye. Avoid unnecessary details. Don't just talk about every little thing that, oh, I use this model to train it. Then we use K-means with three clusters. They don't know K-means. They don't care about K-means. So just tell them what they need to know. Define and understand your audience. Are you talking to business people or are you talking to the data team of Harambe? You're going to have different presentations if you're talking to the MD, the CEO, or if you're talking to the lead of the data science team. And humanize your data. It's not just bar charts and histograms. And how does it relate to them? How does it relate to their clients? How does it relate to their business? And then don't. Don't determine the narrative before you start. You want to prove that women do not work, and then that's all you're looking for in the data. Don't go there. Let the data lead your story. And then do not spend more time on the presentation than on actually doing the work, the analysis, and questioning the validity of what you found. The presentation has to be nice, but it shouldn't take most of your time. Storytelling cannot be a shortcut that you actually don't do the actual work. You must make sure that the actual work, the proper methodologies have been put into place. And then do not analyze the data without the big picture. I saw an example, I don't remember it well, a company that was monitoring tweets, and they saw a spike on hashtag jobs, so that, oh, people are talking more and more and more about jobs and unemployment, and. But no, Steve Jobs passed away. So you always have to be in context, see the big picture. And yeah, as I said earlier, do not use storytelling as a shortcut. Use it as a way to really just convey the actual stuff, the actual work that you did. And that's it. And questions now.
Questions? Oui. Questions. So before we go to questions, is Jan Orestes in the audience here? No? No? Okay. Questions? Please put up your hand and wait for the microphone so that we can hear you.
Hi, thank you very much. I'd like to say this was very helpful because I need as many people as possible to tell me not to make things complicated. I wanted to ask a bit about the accompanying content to a presentation. Usually we're asked by some third party to go and do a bit of research, and we work very hard to keep that presentation very simple. But do you have any guidance around what else you should hand over? Often we feel that if we hand over code or we hand over notebooks, they're not really going to be understood. But we also want to hand over stuff for reproducibility so that someone else could reproduce it. So I don't know if you have any comments around that. For instance, what did you hand over to Harambe, for instance?
Well, I feel like if they ask for the stuff, if they say, oh, we're still going to use the stuff because we have a data team, or we have an IT team that actually wants to use the insight and do something with it, then you can do it. But it doesn't stop you from also having a different presentation where you just share your findings. But if they need the actual code and stuff because they actually have people who will use it, then yeah, you just have to define what is going to who. Who am I talking to, and prepare for them, I think.
Yeah, thanks for your talk. I'm interested in sort of the storytelling bit, right? Because that's, I think, even behavioral economics, like people like stories, have a beginning, like a middle and end. Correlation is equal to causation, and like we can tell like a single thread of a story throughout. And that's nice if it's clean. What do you do when your story is messy? Because that's how it usually happens. Your data doesn't always correlate. You had a confusion matrix. Sometimes that might itself not be telling you something that you might not want to know. But people want to find an insight, and you're the data scientist, you're the PhD student, give me an answer, and it's messy, right? You can say some things about your data, but you can't necessarily essentially be concrete about it or whatever. Do you have like any sort of comment on that?
Yes. What I want to say is that if you follow the research approach and you start with a problem, then you have the problem and you try to answer that. It doesn't, like if you're doing research as a PhD, for example, it doesn't mean that your project is going to work. I'm going to try and see what this machine learning is going to do. I will not guarantee you that it's going to achieve 95%. So that's the problem with businesses, because they do not understand data science. They think it's not data science. They think it's data magic. I want to achieve this objective. They want you to do something for their business objective, but that's not the point of storytelling. So it has to be explained to them beforehand. It's not going to be the point of my story. My story is just going to give you insight. It's what I found in the data. It's grounded in the data. It doesn't aim to answer a business objective. It just answers a problem. What does my data say about this problem? And I cannot guarantee the outcome.
Questions? Anyone? Anybody? Haha.
Hi, Diana. Thanks. That was really great. I think one of the biggest challenges we encounter when talking to audiences is about an assumption of statistical or even just a certain type of way of reasoning and about quantitative information. Do you have any suggestions about how best to gauge an audience and so then adjust your message accordingly based upon are there people who are comfortable with like frequency statistics, or is this a group of people who, you know, really mustn't do anything than a bar chart with like three columns on it, you know?
I feel like personally, when I work with doctors, they like a lot of charts. Doctors want charts, and you just have to try and humanize it for them. And people who are more in business, they really like the story. People in business like the story. People in IT and engineer, they are just weird. So, yeah. So, yeah. I don't know if I answered your question.
More questions? Anyone?
No, they're done.
So, if you have follow-up questions, please find Diana during lunch. So, lunch is going to be at 12:30. There are just some announcements. First of all, the talk which was supposed to be in this session about malware has now been moved to the session after lunch, assuming that we can find the speaker. We're trying. And a reminder, all speakers and organizers, please go out the back entrance for a group photo at the start of lunch. Thank you. And let's have another round of applause for Diana.